Forgive me for standing down here to give a homily. I've never been able to give a homily from a pulpit. I think it stemmed from one parish that I was assigned to very early, where you went up like four steps to get into the pulpit, and the pulpit hit me right about here. And at that point, I was always worried about falling out of it. So I never used the pulpit, and I've never used one since. So my apologies. I like to walk around. I got a will you in the way? The first reading, God destroys death. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
Then say it.
God destroys death.
The people down the street can't hear you. Say it again. It's the whole reason we're here at this Mass. It's the whole reason we hear the Mass on a daily basis. We make the statement that God, present in the world, and the person we know as Jesus, whom we title the Christ, died and gave us the fullness of life. We have an additional reality in today's Mass because we say, Will has died, and Will has entered into the fullness of life. Will and God are once again walking in harmony with one another. We continue to believe and to say then that God and God's creation created us for a purpose. God created all of creation for a purpose. To know.
To serve.
You remember. remember your catechism. Very good. To know, to love, and to serve. And I will offer to you today that that's what Will Frenzel did. Will entered into the reality of creation by knowing, loving, and serving his Creator. When we look at creation, we can find that by and large, we look at creation from the point of life. God instills life into the world. God makes the fish. God makes the human beings. God gives life. What if you reflect on the world and the reality of creation from the lens of death? God created in death. We read, whether it's Genesis 1 and 2, or we read whether we accept the scientific view of the Big Bang, something dies that something may come into existence. Genesis says that in the beginning, the world was without form. It was void. It was chaotic. It was covered with water. It lived and existed in darkness. And then the act of creation begins. Chaos, the disruptiveness, the lack of form dies when God creates. We find that the sense of this waters covering the face of the earth dies when God separates the waters into the abyss and the water in the dry land is created. We read and say that God saw this primordial darkness and that God created light even before the sun and the moon and the star were created. God creates life. And on the first day, there is morning and evening. That everyday aspect of death and resurrection that we experience. The sun rises, life. The sun sets, death. Dark and light. A constant reality. We find that at the pinnacle of creation, God creates the Adam and Eve, and God walks in the garden with them, arm in arm. Until one day, God doesn't walk in the garden anymore with them. That unique and special relationship that God has with God's creation dies. Adam and Eve were cast out of the garden. We look at it from the aspect of the Big Bang theory, and we find that in the beginning there was nothing. Now, we can't really conceive nothing. When we try to conceive nothing, there's always something. But there's nothing there, and all of a sudden, something is. The nothingness dies to something. That something explodes, and it goes out into an ever-expanding cosmos and universe, and in that cosmos and universe are the basic building blocks of reality and material life. The subatomic particles, the electromagnetic fields, the basic chemical composition. And over billions of years, they combine, they break apart, they combine, they break apart. So it's a constant living and a constant dying. Until something changes. And that something changes when, on a small speck of a planet in the vast universe, God creates life. Up until then, there is non-life. Non-life now dies because God creates life. And so God creates life and God brings life into the world. But all of this has come about because of death. And then the reason that we are here for happens. For God, in the personage of Jesus Christ, fully God, fully human, the second person of the Trinity, Jesus, whom we name and title the Christ, comes on the face of the earth, is present. The absence of God, which was spoken of in Genesis, now dies. God, once again, is walking with human beings on the face of the earth. And what is even more amazing is that God enters into the fullness of our reality, just as Will Frenzel has entered into the fullness of that reality. God, like Will, dies. It matters not whether God dies in his sleep at the age 33. It doesn't matter whether he went out that morning on the lake and got all tangled up in one of Peter's nets, fell out of the boat and drowned. It doesn't matter that God was crucified on a cross. God died. And then that pattern that was present all the way from existence, the beginning, from Genesis, or the initial Big Bang, is broken. Because we proclaim what? 3 days later, the tomb is
empty.
Come on.
Empty.
The tomb is empty. It's not that God becomes like the tree that falls in the forest and rots in the forest, and that the basic elements of the atoms and of the chemicals and of everything else recombine, and all of a sudden you have lichen and moss, weeds and trees. We believe in a bodily resurrection. There's not a reforming, there's a continuation. We continue in the life that God has given to us, and that is the reason we are here to celebrate Will Frenzel. Will Frenzel has entered into the fullness of that life, which is an immense and an amazing gift by Almighty God. Who was Will Frenzel? How did he know, love, and serve his God? For the first 10 years of my ordination, Will Frenzel was a name, and Will Frenzel was a face at meetings. You'd walk in, Will Frenzel guy, let's see, he's one of those mountain priests. He's like hopping jams, and he's like biting, and that was about all I knew of him until I was assigned by Bishop Ackerman to the parish of Ravenna, which also comprised Beattyville and Jackson. And there, first serving with Terry Hoppenjams, and then with Will Frenzel, he became my pastor. And that's where I began a relationship and a friendship with Will. For the first, and I was only with him for a year and a half, and then I was named as a pastor in my own right to Berea. But Berea was a parish that Will had. And so I called Will up and said, Will, I haven't got a clue what I'm doing. Could you give me some kind of advice? And Will patiently would say, well, you might want to consider this. Oh, yeah, that's so-and-so, and here's their background, and so on. But Will, even as he was pastor, did the same thing as I was a pastor. Will would allow me to listen to him, to take all his advice. And Will could get kind of minutiae when he gave advice, do this and do that, A, B, C, and so on. And he knew I might or probably not accept it. Will always said when I was his associate, so I'd come in, you were new to the mountains, I would tell you what to do in the mountains and how this program was to be done. And he said, after a while, I realized, he says, you got this little grin on your face, and I knew you already had figured out how you were going to do it. And you weren't going to follow what I told you. And he says, you know what made me mad is it was better than So I received it from Will, and Will became a very dear and close friend. Eventually, Will and I started going on vacations together. Eventually, we were joined by Father Frank Osberg, although Frank always likes to say, wait a minute, I went first, and then you joined in. But anyhow, the three of us did this for 25 or 30 years, every summer. Will, as you well know, loved the outdoors. So it was always in camping. And if you really want to get to know a person, because this is how Will started out our camping trips, you drove for 30 to 36 hours straight in a small van, and if you want to know somebody, try doing that. I'm sure by the end of it, he knew me, and I knew him. Knew Frank. Frank knew me, Frank knew Will. And so from there, this reality of beginning to say, I know who this man is, developed. And today I'll offer just two out of the many things that Will Frenzel was, just two ideas about Will Frenzel that hopefully you remember and take home with you. First of all, I began to realize that Will Frenzel, when he greeted a person, always greeted somebody, whether they were longtime friends or new acquaintances, with three words. Although when they came out of Will's mouth, they were one word made of six letters. And it was H-W-A-R-Y-A. How are you? Became hiya. Hiya. And when you would meet Will, you eventually learned and understood. When Will looked at you and said, hiya, Will really wanted to know. You could respond taking an hour to tell Will how you were, and he would patiently sit there and listen to you. His concern for other people, and particularly his brother priests, was so great that he would take the time, no matter how busy he was, no matter what else was going on, he would listen to you, and he would accept you. The second aspect that I offer for your remembrance about Will is that one year I talked Will into going with me to a workshop. Will Frenzel was not a workshop priest. He despised the things. But I talked him into going because I said, Will, it's up in Chicago. I don't want to go up on myself. Will you go with me? Because I have a number of this man's books. I read them. I use them in my homily preparation. And I would really like to meet him individually. Listen to his workshop. Be able to speak to him. So Will agreed to go along. Now, the man was very good in his presentation, but in his presentations, he would have the habit of saying, what do you think about that? Don't panic on my queen. I just want to faint. What do you think? Does that mean, do you agree with what I just said? And sometimes the man got into what best could be explained as speculative theology. What the heck is this guy talking about? Where is he going with this? And on one particularly difficult afternoon, he pointed to Will Frenzel. I remember sitting there saying, oh, this ought to be rare. Will's response, I remember the words exactly to today. He looked at that man and he said, Father, I don't understand a word that you're saying. Because I am a simple mountain priest. If somebody was to etch on Will's tombstone something about Will's life, I would offer that the top thing that should be considered is that Will was a simple mountain priest. With all apologies to the people of Seton, who he served so well, Will identified that he was a simple mountain priest. After when we were driving home, I said, Will, what did you say that for? You are much more than just a simple mountain priest. I was kind of taking it as a put down of himself. And then realized, no, he deeply and sincerely meant it. He understood himself as a simple mountain priest. But Will was very complex. There was not a whole lot really all that simple about Will. Will lived simply. He didn't demand much. But there was a greater depth to Will than many people would realize. For Will completely and fully embraced his creative reality of to know, love, and serve his Creator. Will loved deeply his God. Will loved deeply his church. Will had a special fondness and remembrance and the ability to love the people of the parishes to whom he was assigned as their pastor. Will loved the West. My understanding is, I guess if we could open the coffin, the vestment that he's got on the inside, they would avoid it with a horse and a saddle. Because this, Will loved Louis L'Amour. We'd go on trips and, Will, what do you read? Louis L'Amour. How many times have you read it, Will? All six or seven. Will, try another series. Oh, no, I love Will L'Amour. So Will was his great desire. And in that great desire, Frank and Will and I at one point had decided we'd get to all 50 states. Will didn't make it to Hawaii. And the only reason he didn't make it to Hawaii was because of the onset of the illness that we all know so well afflicted him. In closing, I would ask that as we leave here today after celebrating the death and resurrection of Almighty God, the death and resurrection and the fullness of life of Will Frenzel, that either here at the reception or when you get home, if you have the opportunity, take a glass. I don't care what beverage you got in it. Hold the glass up. And give thanks to Almighty God for the death and resurrection, the fullness of life. Give thanks to Almighty God for the reality that Will Frenzel, a great service to his family and to his friends, a priest who loved other priests dearly, is now walking arm in arm in the fullness of creation with his Creator. We really don't know what creation, what it's like when you get up into heaven and what existence is and how it works. But in your own mind's eye, picture Will walking in heaven, arm in arm with Almighty God. But that Will is looking down on some small specks in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And he's turning to his creator and says, I made it to all 50. And so remember that and give thanksgiving to the great gift of Will, who to each one of us wanted to know us and then how I know, and also very much wanted to be a part of us and a service to us. We thank Almighty God for his blessing of Will Frenzel in our lives.